In the parenting class this morning, there was a brief discussion about some of the cultural things that are happening around us and how we might protect our children's hearts from those things. It seems that moral boundaries are collapsing all around us, doesn't it? But as we said in class, that's not a new thing. People are always challenging God's designs of morality and the things that God has said. But it does seem that these boundaries are collapsing, and we are watching the foundations of society crumble around us. And we notice that many people in our society are increasingly tolerant of behaviors and attitudes that once were considered aberrant. We hear people justifying things that even just a decade or two ago, no one would have sought to justify, or at least not as many would have sought to justify them. And when I stand up in this pulpit and I open my Bible and I talk about those kinds of behaviors, I talk about those attitudes that are emerging in the culture around us, I point to Scripture, and these matters are usually pretty black and white, aren't they? They're pretty well defined. And so I preach what the Bible says on those kinds of things, and somebody says, well, you know, you're just intolerant. You're just being hateful. You're not open-minded. You're closed-minded. You are a simpleton in your thinking. But it doesn't just happen in cultural things. This also happens in religious realms as well. In the religious world at large, people have a much wider opinion on matters like how someone comes to God, how someone ought to worship God and serve Him. And there are many religious groups around us who are much more tolerant than I think the Bible says they should be. But they would look at someone like me and say, well, you're not as tolerant as you ought to be. Sometimes, perhaps oftentimes, both culturally and religiously, I think there's a mutual misunderstanding that's taking place. When we engage people in our society about cultural differences that we have, I think sometimes we're talking past each other because we are approaching the conversation from two completely different perspectives. And I think the same thing happens in our religious discussions. We don't understand each other because we are approaching the conversation from two completely different angles. This misunderstanding that happens between us, I think, is oftentimes boiled down to this. For one person, it's a matter of preference. But for the opposing side, it's a matter of principle. And you see, when we approach a discussion with someone with whom we disagree, and in one person's mind, this disagreement is simply a matter of preference, but in the other person's mind, it's a matter of principle, those two people are never going to come to a mutual agreement because they're approaching the disagreement from different perspectives. Let me give you a cultural example, and then we'll consider some religious examples later in the lesson. The gay rights agenda that has been moving in earnest in the past few decades. What is the term that has been used for that? Well, this is just their sexual preference, right? You see it? This is their preference. And to those who are advocating the gay rights and the homosexual agenda, that's all it is. It all just comes down to, look, we like what we like, you like what we like, let's agree to disagree, and let's just be at peace with each other. Why can't we accept each other? It's just a matter of preference. But to the person like me who opposes that behavior, it is not a matter of preference in my mind, is it? I see this as a matter of principle. It is foundational principle that's being violated. This is not just a matter of, well, do you like chocolate ice cream or vanilla ice cream? It's much deeper than that. And now we're dealing with the transgenderism issues. and we hear people using the same kind of language. Select your gender preference. But this is not an issue of preference, is it? At least not for us. Not when it comes to the Bible. This is not a preference issue. It's a principle matter. And when I am having a dialogue with someone who thinks that these are just preferences, we're not going to see eye to eye because it's much more than that to me. In religious matters, we see the same thing. Religiously, what some people call preference, I see it as principle. I say, no, I don't agree with that religious practice. Not because I don't like it, not because it's simply not my preference, but because there is a principle that is at play here that we need to consider. Are you with me on this? You understand where I'm going? So what is the principle? I think there is a very simple, overarching idea present in both Old Testament and New Testament that governs how we approach God and Scripture. And the overarching principle is this. If you're looking for something profound, you're not going to get it here. All right? Let me show you how simple this is. Here's the principle. Whatever God says to do, that's what we've got to do. If God commands it, we must do it. That's the principle. You say, oh, that seems so simple. And it is. But we fight and we argue about this all the time when it comes to religious discussions. Now, there's some other things involved in this, I understand, but that's the overarching principle. And we understand this principle in others. That over to Tim's pharmacy. I go to pick up my prescription. I walk in to pick that up, and Tim says, you know, I know what the doctor said you should have on your prescription. But, you know, I think you would be better served over here. What would you think about that? Didn't say you couldn't use this other medicine over here. Fill my prescription the way the doctor said to fill it. This is an illustration that preachers from before the age of Ronnie have been using. This is a very simple illustration, but it works. If a mother sends her child to the grocery store with $10 and she says, I need you to get eggs, milk, and bread. Of course, today she'd have to send him with $30. But if she sent him with $10 and said, get milk and eggs and bread, what does she want him to buy? It's pretty simple, right? What did she command? She commanded milk and eggs and bread. If he comes back with a bunch of candy and ice cream and all kinds of other junk food in addition to the milk, the eggs, and the bread, you think mama's going to be happy about that? Well, she's going to say, well, who told you you could buy all this other junk food? Well, you know, you didn't say not to. I just thought it'd be okay. You see, we understand this principle in other realms of life. Do what you're told to do. But when it comes to religious things, we say, well, you know, that's different. We got to approach the Bible in a completely different kind of a way. There's got to be something different about the Bible. No, there doesn't. No, there really doesn't. Get your Bible. Let's go to Exodus chapter 40. I want to show you a few examples of this idea. Do whatever the Lord commanded you to do. Now, as you're turning to Exodus 40, you're probably aware that in the chapters leading up to Exodus 40, God is giving Moses all of the instructions about how to build the tabernacle. He gives him very precise instructions about the dimensions, about the furniture that's to be placed inside the tabernacle. And he talks about the color of the curtains that are to be used in the tabernacle. God did not spare details in this. You can look through these chapters and read about it. And in Exodus chapter 40, all of this culminates in the completion of the tabernacle. Exodus chapter 40, look at verse 16. Thus Moses did according to all that the Lord had commanded him, so he did. You're going to see that expression repeatedly throughout the chapter. Look at verse 19. Just as the Lord had commanded Moses. Verse 21. Just as the Lord had commanded Moses. Verse 23. Just as the Lord commanded Moses. If we were teaching elementary school students, we would say, okay, little Johnny, what are you starting to notice here? A pattern, he would say, right? Triangle, square, triangle, square. What comes next, Johnny? Right? He'd put this together. So what do we see here? You see a bunch of triangles. Every two verses, it's the same thing every time. Verse 25, just as the Lord had commanded Moses. It's there in verse 27, 29, and 32. Just as God commanded. You see that? Now, when Moses finishes everything with the tabernacle, notice what happens in verse 34. He finishes the work in verse 33, and then verse 34 says, then the cloud covered the tent of meeting, and the glory of the Lord filled the tabernacle. This is what God does in response to Moses and the people fulfilling his requirements. God's glory, his presence, comes into the tabernacle. Now, I can't speak for God, but I do wonder, if Moses had completely disregarded God's instructions about the tabernacle, would God's presence have filled the tabernacle just the same? And I don't presume to know that, but I'm curious about it. I'm not saying that God's presence came solely because Moses did everything God said, but I have to think those things are related. Go to Leviticus chapter 8. This one is even more compelling to me. Leviticus chapter 8, you have here in the first seven chapters, you have the various sacrifices and offerings that God's people and the priests are supposed to give. And after spending seven chapters talking about those offerings, now in chapter 8, the focus of the book shifts over to the priesthood. And in chapter 8, there's a discussion about a seven-day-long consecration period. 7 days of consecration. Chapter 8, verse 2, I want you to notice who is present. Take Aaron and his sons. You're going to see that expression multiple times throughout chapter 8, 9, and 10. Aaron and his sons, they are the people under consideration. Aaron is the high priest. His sons are priests after him. Now look at verse 4. So Moses did just as the Lord commanded him. Verse 5. This is the thing which the Lord has commanded to do, Moses said. Verse 9. Just as the Lord had commanded Moses. Verse 13. Just as the Lord had commanded Moses. Again, you see that expression time and time again. And this consecration period that lasts for 7 days, Moses and Aaron and Aaron's sons are going through these very meticulous, detailed instructions about how to consecrate the priests. And there are a lot of seemingly strange things that you read about in Leviticus chapter 8. They take the blood of an offering, for instance, and they put it on the earlobe of Aaron and his sons. That seems kind of strange, but that's what God told them to do. And so Moses is doing that. Verse 17, just as the Lord commanded Moses. Verse 21, verse 29, verse 31, verse 34, verses 35 and 36. Each of those verses uses that expression or something very similar. Just as the Lord commanded. In chapter 9, verse 1, it came about on the 8th day. So now the 7 day consecration period is over. And now the 8th day has come. Verse 9 says Aaron and his sons and the elders of Israel were present. And on this 8th day, there are other procedural things that the people are to do. Verse 5. So they took what Moses had commanded. But Moses commanded it because it came from God. Verse 6. Moses says, this is the thing which the Lord has commanded you to do. Verse 7, verse 10, verse 16, verse 21, just as God commanded. 18 times in chapters 8 and 9, you see the expression, just as God commanded. You also see one occasion where the word ordinance is used. That's verse 16 of chapter 9. He offered it according to the ordinance, which is another word for command. 18 times in these two chapters. Aaron's sons, Aaron, the high priest, and Moses are observing all of these detailed, meticulous things that God has instructed them to do. And they're doing it to the letter, because that's what God prescribed. Now notice, familiar story, chapter 10, verse 1. Now Nadab and Abihu, the sons of Aaron, took their respective fire pans, and after putting fire in them, placed incense on it and offered strange fire before the Lord, which he had not commanded them. That is a point of great contrast. For two chapters, they've been observing all the things that God commanded. And here on the eighth day that started in chapter 9, now two of Aaron's sons do something which God did not command them to do. What happens? You know what happened. Verse 2, fire came out from the presence of the Lord and consumed them, and they died before the Lord. Did it matter to God that his instructions were followed? Of course it did. And Aaron and his sons have been watching and observing all of these things that God commanded them to do. Nadab and Abihu have been watching and going through all of these procedures. And you wonder if they ever thought, why is Moses being so meticulous about all this? Why is Moses being so detailed about it? Why is he doing all of this? This just seems to be a little bit much. Well, they found out, didn't they? They found out why Moses was doing all of these things in such a detailed way. In fact, let's make another connection here. If you go back to chapter 9, after going through all of this consecration business, verse 23, the end of the chapter, Moses and Aaron went into the tent of meeting. When they came out and blessed the people, the glory of the Lord appeared to all the people. Then fire came out from before the Lord and consumed the burnt offering and the portions of fat on the altar. And when all the people saw it, they shouted and fell on their faces. The fire comes from the presence of God here in a good way. It consumes the sacrifice and it says, yes, this is what I wanted. I am accepting the worship that you have given to me. But when fire comes out from the presence of God in chapter 10, it consumes Nadab and Abihu in judgment. Why? Because they didn't do what God commanded. In verse 1, when it says that they offered strange fire, I remember when I was a kid thinking strange fire. You know, fire is yellow, orange in color. Strange fire must have been like purple, you know? That's not the idea. The word strange is the same word used in the Old Testament for stranger, foreigner, someone who is outside. And doesn't the end of verse 1 help us understand what strange means? Which he had not commanded them. The fire which they offered was an outsider to the things which God had said. Now, what specifically was their offense? I'm not exactly sure I know. There are some, and I think with good reason, who connect this to chapter 16 of Leviticus. There's a discussion there about the Day of Atonement. When the high priest goes into the most holy place, he is supposed to bring fire, and that fire is to come from the altar. In other words, he doesn't bring a burning coal from his fireplace at home. That's not where he brings the fire from. He brings it from the altar within the tabernacle. And so maybe Nadab and Abihu's sin was that the source of their fire was from the wrong place. I have no problem with that. I don't know exactly that that's what it was. But whatever it is they did, it's not what God commanded. You see that? You see, God's commands matter, don't they? Let's go to 1 Chronicles chapter 13. 1 Chronicles chapter 13. Another well-known story that illustrates the idea that God's commands matter. 1 Chronicles chapter 13, it's time to move the Ark of the Covenant. And in chapter 13 and in verse 7, the text says that the people carried, literally the text says they caused it to ride. And that will be significant in the next expression. They carried the Ark of God on a new cart from the house of Abinadab. And Uzzah and Ahio drove the cart. They take the Ark of the Covenant and they put it on a trailer. But God had given them some instructions about how the Ark was to be moved. In fact, let me just throw this out there. When it comes to the Ark, God gave three very simple rules. Number one, you put poles in the sides and you carry it on your shoulders. That was one of the rules God gave. You carry it. Number two, he specified who was to carry it. Levites of the sons of Kohath. They were the ones responsible for moving the holy furniture from the tabernacle and the temple. Carry it. Only the sons of Kohath. And rule number three was never, ever touch it. You know what happens in the story, right? The ark is being carried on this cart, driven by oxen. And the text says in verse 9 that the oxen stumbled and Uzzah put out his hand to steady the ark. He touched it. But this is not just a story about one of those rules being broken. They've broken all three of those in this episode. They're not carrying it on their shoulders. They put it on a cart. The Kohathites are not doing their job of carrying it because they've put it on this cart and Uzzah touched it. And when that happens, verse 10, the anger of the Lord burned against Uzzah, so he struck him down because he put out his hand to the ark and he died there before the ark of, or before God. But please don't miss what happens two pages later in chapter 15. It's time to move it again. The ark sat still for a while. We had to let things settle down a little bit. And now in chapter 15, it's time to move it. So David in verse 11 calls for the priests, for the Levites. And he says in verse 12, you are the heads of the father's households of the Levites. Consecrate yourselves, both you and your relatives, that you may bring up the ark of the Lord God of Israel to the place that I've prepared for it. Now notice verse 13. This is so significant. Because you did not carry it at the first, the Lord our God made an outburst on us, for we did not seek him according to the ordinance. You see, David recognizes long ago, God commanded us something about this ark. And what happened with Uzzah, bad as it was, we did not do what God commanded. And so this time when we move it, I think we should do what God said long ago. I think we should observe God's commandment. Another example, Nehemiah chapter 8. We'll look at this one very quickly. Nehemiah chapter 8, Ezra has been reading the law of God to the people. And they've come across a passage in the law that Israel is to live in temporary shelters, booths or tents that are made out of branches. And they haven't been doing this. They have neglected this command for many years. In verse 14, it says, they found written in the law how the Lord had commanded through Moses that the sons of Israel should live in booths during the feast of the seventh month, the Feast of Tabernacles. They discovered what Moses said many, many centuries before. And now they say, you know, we haven't been doing this. We need to do what God says here. And so verse 18, he read from the book of the law of God daily, from the first day to the last day, and they celebrated the feast 7 days, and on the eighth day there was a solemn assembly according to the ordinance. Let's do what God commanded us to do. Yeah, but Ben, these are all Old Testament examples. All right, let's go to 1 Corinthians chapter 14. 1 Corinthians chapter 14. Now, we're only going to read one verse in this chapter, but let me just tell you what Paul discusses in the chapter. He's talking about spiritual gifts, miraculous spiritual gifts that God's people in the first century possessed, tongue speaking, healing, etc. And chapter 14 is focusing on how God's people in the age of miraculous gifts ought to conduct themselves in the assembly. And so Paul gives a lot of instructions about, well, if this happens, then here's what you do. And if that over there happens, then here's how you deal with that. And he gives all of these instructions. Now, after giving those instructions in precise detail, I mean, we're not talking about the precision of the tabernacle here, but not as much as involved either. But he gives very precise instructions. And now notice what he says at the end in verse 37. If anyone thinks he is a prophet or spiritual, I think that's Paul's way of saying, now, if you're inclined to give me some pushback on this, if you disagree with me on this, here's what you need to know. Let him recognize that the things which I write to you are the Lord's commandment. Does Paul expect the Corinthians to obey the instructions that he's given? I think he does. He says, this is God's commandment that you need to follow. And whatever God has commanded, that's what we ought to do. You see, this principle is so simple, isn't it? If God said it, I need to do it. But when it comes to God's commands, I think we have different types of commands, at least as it pertains to our understanding of God's commands. You know, we have some commands that we see, they have a spiritual value to them. And we recognize that. We don't question the spiritual benefit that comes from some of God's commands. When God gives us instructions about the value of prayer and worship, we see that. We say, you know what? We're going to grow. We're going to mature in Christ. We're going to be stronger. We're going to have greater relationships with our brethren. We see those commands. We understand the spiritual value. And so we say, yes, we ought to do that. There are moral commands which God gives. Don't steal. Don't commit adultery. Don't murder. We see the value of that. We understand that. It's logical. And so we say, let's make sure we do what God said or we don't do the things God said not to do because we understand the moral benefit. But you know, there may be a third category. Commands that we don't understand. Are there commands in the Bible that just don't make any sense? I think there are. And if we put our heads together and we thought for a little while, I think we would all come up with some commands, Old Testament or New Testament, especially Old Testament though, that just don't seem to make any logical sense to us. I'm not saying there's no logical sense. I'm saying we don't perceive it. We might look at those dietary restrictions in Leviticus chapter 11, those food laws, and we might say, boy, I don't get that at all. That doesn't mean God doesn't get it. That doesn't mean God didn't have reasons for giving those laws, whether we see them or not. But the question before us is, even when I don't see the value in what God has said, if I don't see the logic in what God has said, am I still going to do what God said? That's the issue. Fire is fire. thought Nadab and Abihu. What difference does it make? All we need is a hot coal. Does it matter where it comes from? Fire is fire. No, it's really not. And they learned that lesson the hard way. Why does God say we have to carry the ark on poles? I mean, does he not know how heavy this thing is? We all have solid wood furniture, right? Or at least we did at one time. None of us enjoy moving that. It's heavy. And it's not just wood. It's overlaid with gold. This is really heavy stuff. Why do we have to carry it? What would be wrong with loading it up on a trailer with wheels? Man, that would be so nice. Could you get the 4x4 truck and let's put the thing in the bed? That'd be so much easier. Why do we have to carry this thing? I don't know, but that's what God said to do, whether it makes sense to me or not. Now let's give some religious examples that we see in our experience today. Maybe you're visiting with us today, and this is the first time you've ever visited with a congregation like ours. I almost said the first time you've ever visited with a church of Christ. But you know, that doesn't even really help us as much in our world today. Because even churches that bear the name Church of Christ differ on some of the things that used to be defining traits of churches of Christ. So maybe you're visiting with us for the first time and you've recognized that there's no instruments of music up here. In some churches of Christ, there are. But maybe that stands out to you and you say, that's interesting. Every other church I've ever been to has had instruments of music. They've had at least a piano or an organ, or some of them have full-on bands and they have drums and guitars and so forth. Where is that? Well, let me use the two terms that I started with. While for many in the religious world, that might be a preference issue. Well, we just like having instrumental music. Or, you know, we prefer not to just have a piano or a keyboard. We prefer to have the whole band up on the stage. But it's a preference thing. But understand, here, it's not a matter of preference. It's a principle matter. We don't not have instruments here because we don't like instruments. We don't have them because of the principle behind it. We can take you to passages of Scripture that say, this is what God said, and this is how God said he wants to be worshiped. And so that's what we're doing. You may have noticed that only men have been up before us today, leading singing and leading prayers and preaching and so forth. Where are the women? Well, for some groups, it's a preference thing. But for us, it's a principle thing. You believe baptism is necessary for salvation? Yes. And you believe then in immersion into water, complete immersion, not sprinkling or pouring or some other kind of... Yes. Why? Believe me, that is not preference. Oh my word, I have baptized people so many times and the water goes down in my waders and my socks get all sloshy and wet. It is not a matter of preference. My preference would be there. You're clean. That would be my preference. But you see, there's a principle here. There's passages of Scripture that we can point to and say, this is what God said. We observe the Lord's Supper every Lord's Day. Not all religious groups do that. Some do it only on holidays, Christmas, Easter, maybe some other special kind of occasion. But for us, we do it every Lord's Day. Why? Preference? Principle. We believe these are the things that God has said to do. All of these things, and there are more. These are things that some in the religious world just consider to be a preference. Well, you can do those things however you want to. You can do those things whether or not you want to. It's all about what you prefer. It's not that way here. Our position on these matters is not about opinion or what we like or don't like. It is about what did God say. And please understand that I am not saying any of these things this morning from a position of pride or arrogance that, well, we've got it all figured out and everybody else is missing the mark. That's not what I'm after. In fact, just a couple of days ago, I got an email from a very kind and conscientious young lady saying, I am trying to have religious discussions with a friend of mine with whom I disagree on these things, and I'm not exactly sure where to begin. How do I talk with her about these kinds of issues? And I responded to her and I said, I'm happy to talk to you at length about this, but for now, would you just listen to the sermon that I'm about to preach on Sunday? Because I think it will help us if we have this understanding. Maybe we're approaching this dialogue from two different perspectives. I'm trying to take a principled stand on something, but that may not be where she is. She may not see this the same way. And if we can get that out and acknowledge it, then maybe we can say, now let me explain why I have the principle. Let me explain why this is not just a matter of opinion or preference. Let's get on the same page at the starting point, and then let's work from there. But if what is principle to me is simply preference to somebody else, we will never come to agreement. We will never come to agreement because opinions do not carry the same weight as principles, do they? Well, you know, I like instrumental music and I don't have any problem with it. I don't have any problem against it. If somebody doesn't want to do it, that's fine. If they want to do it, that's fine. It's all of our opinions on the matter. But somebody else says, no, this is much more serious than that. It's a principle issue. The weight of principle is far more substantial than the weight of opinion. And that's why we'll never disagree or never agree. You understood what I meant. Because we're coming at it from two different places. So maybe you're here this morning and you have questions. Ask them. Ask them. We won't be offended. And we promise to treat you with dignity and respect and do our best to answer your question. But we do believe that these are the things that God has said. And we want to show you in His Word why we believe that. There may be someone here today who is ready to put on Jesus Christ in baptism for the remission of your sins and begin walking in newness of life with Him. We are ready to assist you in that. Or if you need to return to the Lord, repent of your sins and offer prayers for God's forgiveness. We will help you do that. We invite you. Please come even now as we stand and sing together.